That's in Luke and in Acts, the same author. Now in Matthew, Judas hangs himself. And toward the end, the 11 go to Galilee. In Mark's gospel, Jesus appeared to the 11, but not in John. That's why I love the gospel of John, you know, y'all. I love the gospel of John. Because Jesus appears to all the disciples, except Thomas, who was one of the 12. It's a remarkable arresting phrase that really messed with me to read after the resurrection in light of the other gospels and to realize that in John, no one is missing. Judas hasn't fallen headlong in a field or hung himself or just disappeared from this story. No, in John, they are whole. They are still 12 disciples, not 11. You see, it's unconditional acceptance. Radical love, inclusive love, love of the enemy. Have I accepted the people who've hurt me back? Or do I hold a grudge, feel resentment, harbor ill feelings toward them? Have I let go? God has accepted me. Why can't I accept those who have betrayed me? It's a complete rewriting of the gospel record and of Judas's story. It's an alternate ending where Jesus really does keep his promise that he would not lose even one given to him. In John 6, 39, chapter 6, verse 39, "And this is the will of the one who sent me," says Jesus, "that I should not lose anything of what he gave me, but that I should raise it on the last day." You and I are here tonight to experience being found by God. It is not you who have chosen Jesus, it is he who has chosen you. It's not you who have found him, it's he who has found you, because he loves you and wants to give you that gift of peace that only comes from being his follower in a radical way, loving all those people, all the people, as uncomfortable as they might be to love. You know, there's no big fanfare of forgiveness or reconciliation in John. No huge summit about how it all went down, but somehow Judas was lost and then he was found. He's just there in the background, desperately happy to be there. Oh, isn't that just mess with you right now? Relieved he's not bleeding out in a field or swinging from a rope in a field or completely erased from the resurrection, because the odds for reconciliation and forgiveness are stacked against him. 3/4 of the time, because there are 4 gospels, he winds up dead or lost. But this one time, one miraculous time, one merciful time, there is quiet, unassuming forgiveness done behind closed doors. This one miraculous time, Judas lives. In John's telling, Judas, this evil or tragic figure throughout Christian history, is suddenly transformed by his fellow disciples' love into the first person whose sins the disciples choose not to retain, but to forgive. And this is what you are here to experience this evening, that the Lord Jesus, when he breathed the Holy Spirit on the apostles, whose successors we are here as ordained priests. We continue in the line of that apostolic succession. That when Jesus breathed on them, he said, "Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins are retained are retained." Whose sins you retain are retained. And you are here to experience what Judas experienced in John's gospel. forgiveness. When we hear Judas's name, we are conditioned to think of betrayal, pettiness, or greed. It's striking that as Christians, we don't immediately think of forgiveness. It should stop us and make us think why Christian history for 2,000 years hasn't found a way to forgive him. But it shouldn't surprise us, because we continue to preach forgiveness and yet we don't practice it so many times in our lives. We teach forgiveness, but do we embody it? We believe in forgiveness, but do we live it? Is another story. You know, I was a priest in Northern California in a small town called Crescent City, which is on the border of Oregon. And all of this information that I'm giving you, you can Google it when you go home if you don't believe me. And the town closest to where I was assigned as a priest was Eureka, California. And I was living there in a rectory by myself in Crescent City with a lot of transient people coming through. And I was the only priest in the town. And in the neighboring town, Eureka, the priest there also lived in the rectory in much the same way, with people knocking on our doors at all hours of the night looking for handouts. And his name was Father Eric Freed. And on January 1st, 2014, I'm in the rectory after celebrating morning mass, because it was a holy day of obligation, the feast of Mary, Mother of God. And I'm in the rectory and the phone rings and it's the bishop. And he says, "Lock yourself in the rectory and do not come out, because Father Eric at St. Bernard Church in Eureka has just been found murdered." He was murdered by a mentally ill man. And the bishop didn't know whether this man was out trying to murder priests, because he carved into Father Eric's body all sorts of satanic symbols. The man was eventually found in a nearby town. His name is Gary Lee Bullock. And this past May was the sentencing phase of the trial for Gary Lee Bullock, in which he was sentenced to life in prison for the murder and torture, brutal murder and torture of Father Eric Freed. And in May, at the sentencing phase of the trial, Father Eric's two sisters both got to testify at the trial. And he was the neighboring pastor, and so the neighboring priest. So I got to know him and his family, particularly during that time when they came for the funeral. And so I got to know his two sisters. One of them is a non-believer. She doesn't believe. She has no religion. She rejected the Catholic faith she was baptized into, and she doesn't practice any faith. But the other sister is a practicing Christian. Linda is her name. And at the sentencing phase of the trial, the two sisters got to get up and testify, as happens at trials. And the first sister got up and said, as she looked at Gary Lee Bullock, she said, "I hate you. You murdered my brother. And not only did you murder him, but you tortured him. Ever since this happened," she said, "I haven't been able to sleep. I've quit my job. I'm on medication. I will never forgive you. And I wish," she said, and this is all recounted in the papers, "I wish that I could be there to pull the trigger or turn the switch of the electric chair or insert the needle into your arm. I will never forgive you." And you know what Gary Lee Bullock was doing as she was telling him how much she hates him and despises him? Do you know what he was doing? He was laughing. Because hate does not do anything to a person to melt their hearts. Hate only enslaves you. Revenge only enslaves you. Ill feelings only enslave you. Gary Lee Bullock may be going to prison, but that sister is also in prison, as is demonstrated by her own words, that she has no peace. She has to be on medication. She can't sleep. She's also in prison. And then Linda got up, the Christian, the follower of Jesus, as we are trying to be here. She got up and she said at the trial, she says, "You have just heard my sister tell you how much she hates you. I do not hate you. I love you in the name of Jesus. You murdered my brother." And even before the papers recount, she said, "Even before my brother was buried, I forgave you because I am a follower of the Lord Jesus. I do not hate you. I forgive you and I love you in the name of Jesus." And at that time, Gary Lee Bullock broke down crying. Because that's what forgiveness does. It melts hearts of stone and turns them into hearts made for love alone. This is what Linda has experienced in her life in the midst of immense tragedy. It's what my parents experienced. It's what I have experienced. And it's what we pray that we may here tonight continue to experience in a real and concrete way as the Lord comes to lift whatever burdens we may be feeling in our lives. And so I invite you to stand now as we bathe ourselves with that great presence of the Holy Spirit that will be flowing around here this evening. That Spirit that we feel here. For where two or three are gathered, there I am with them. So the Lord Jesus is here. The Lord Jesus is here to melt our hearts, to fill them with all that we need in order to experience His peace. And so this evening, as we invoke that gift of the Holy Spirit in a real and sacramental way to experience God's mercy and reconciliation, that God forgives everything and anything that we may have done in our lives. Everything and anything. There's nothing that is not forgivable by God. Do not be like the person who comes back and confesses things over and over again because you feel you're not forgiven. God forgives you. This evening you'll be able to hear that when the priest says, I absolve you of your sins, all of them. I absolve you, now absolve your... I absolve you, now let go. Let go to experience that. Don't be like the person who comes back over and over again and has to recount things that have happened to them. Let go. There's nothing that is unforgivable. Hear those words of the Lord Jesus. For the priest takes the person of Jesus in the sacrament of confession. It's not the priest who's forgiving you. It's Jesus in the person of the priest who forgives you. And as you hear those words, internalize them. Take in that gift of peace so that you may experience the freedom God has brought us. And so now we invoke the saints to come and pray for us.
God of Abraham, lead us.
Lead us
to your kingdom. In the fruitfulness, lead us.
Lead us together.
Lead us to freedom.
Lead us to your kingdom, through our laughter and
we pray for that freedom of the Lord this evening, let us close our eyes and reflect on all those times that we have offended the Lord, whatever it is that has been burdening us, those things that we need to let go of and change in our lives. As we reflect, let us ask ourselves these questions. Do I give God time every day in prayer? Am I a person of prayer? Is God number one in my life? Or am I after things? Is my work more important than God? Is some person in my life more important than God? Do I seek to love Him with my whole heart? Have I taken in those words, "Seek ye first my kingdom, and everything else will be added to you"? Have I been involved with some superstitious practices? Or with the occult? Do I consult psychics or horoscopes, thinking that they somehow are more powerful than the God that I am called to serve? Do I seek to surrender myself to God's word as taught by the Holy Catholic Church? Are there other gods in my life, like money, security, power, or people? I have to remember that the Lord Jesus said, unless I prefer Him to all the people in my life, I'm not worthy of Him. Do I prefer Him to everything and everyone in my life? Do I use God's name in vain, lightly or carelessly, saying OMG or other words to profane the holy name of God? Have I wished evil upon another person? Is there something within me that needs to be let go of? Have I deliberately missed Mass on Sundays or holy days of obligation, knowing that I am called to remember each week what the Lord instituted in His memory? Have I tried to observe Sunday as a family day and a day of rest, or do I do needless things on Sunday, things that I could do on other days? Do I honor and obey my parents? Or do I speak ill of them? Do I praise them? Jesus grew up in a culture that didn't just teach Him to honor His parents, but to praise them. Do I lift them up? Do I love them? Have I forgiven them? Have I let go of the things that they have done to me? Have I accepted the fact that my parents loved me and loved me the way they knew how to love me, the way they know how to love me? My brothers, my sisters loved me the way they knew how to love me. All those people in my life that have hurt me wouldn't have done it if they knew what they were doing. Have I neglected my duties as my spouse? As a spouse, have I neglected my duties to my children? Is my work more important than my children? Your children will only be 3 or 4 once. Every day that passes by is a day that will never come back. Are the things in my life more important, my work, than my children? Do I pay attention to them, spend time with them, pray with them? Do I pray before I eat with my family? Do we eat together as a family? Do we make time to eat together, to be together? Or are we always running around busy, busy, busy? Do I give my family a good religious example? Do I try to bring peace into my home life? Am I a person of peace? The Bible says, say only the good things men need to hear. Do only good things flow from my mouth, or do bad words or cuss words or words that kill the spirit of another flow from my mouth? Do I kill other people with my tongue? Do I care for my aged and infirm relatives? Or do I discard them? Do I believe in euthanasia and the killing of the old or the infirm or the sick? Do I believe in assisted suicide? Have I had an abortion or encouraged or helped someone to have an abortion? Do I accept that abortion is murder? Do I accept that life begins at conception and ends with natural death? Have I physically harmed anyone? Have I abused alcohol or drugs by getting drunk or smoking marijuana or other recreational drugs? Do I abuse my body? Do I overeat? Do I exercise? Do I care for the temple that the Lord has given me, the temple that is the place where the Holy Spirit dwells, as the Bible teaches me? Or do I abuse my body with excessive food or alcohol or drugs? Have I given scandal to anyone by the way I live, by saying I am one thing and my actions saying I'm another, thereby leading other people to sin? Am I resentful or angry? Have I harbored hatred in my heart? Have I been faithful to my marriage vows, not just in my actions, but in my thoughts? Remember, Jesus says, even those who think badly about a woman or a man have already committed adultery in their mind. Am I chaste in my thoughts, my words, and my actions? How about, am I chaste in the way I dress? Dressed for church? Or do I just roll out of bed and walk into church with shorts, sandals, or flip-flops, not giving any thought to where I'm going? Do I dress modestly, or do I show everything off? Have I stolen what is not mine? Have I returned or made restitution for what I have stolen? Do I waste time at work, at school, or at home? Do I gamble excessively, thereby denying my family of their needs? Do I pay my debts promptly? Do I share what I have been given with the poor and with my church? Do I give generously to my church? Do I support the church? Do I give out of what God has given me? Is supporting my church, my parish church, first and foremost on my list? Or do I think that I have to give to other charities first? In other words, do I clean the street while having my house dirty? Is that what I do? Or is my parish number one in my sacrificial giving to my parish, to my church? Does it hurt when I give, or do I give joyfully of my time, my talents, and my treasure, or my storing up treasures here on earth? Have I realized that I can't take any of my money with me? that I am called to share what I have been given. Do I seek to share with all those around me? Have I cheated anyone out of what is justly theirs? For example, creditors or insurance companies or big corporations? Have I lied? Have I gossiped? Do I make things up about people? Do I speak badly of others behind their back? Am I sincere in my dealings with others? Or am I critical, always negative and uncharitable in my thoughts of others? Do I say good morning? Do I smile? Do I make an effort to be kind? When people see me, do they see the face of Christ? Do I keep secret what should be kept confidential, or do I just go on telling what others have told me in confidence? Have I injured the reputation of others by my slander, by making things up? Have I consented to impure thoughts? Have I caused them by impure reading, especially on the internet, or in movies, or television, or conversations that are unbecoming of somebody that calls himself a follower of Jesus? Do I engage in bad jokes, dirty jokes? Do I pray at once to banish my impure thoughts and temptations? Am I jealous of what other people have? Or do I celebrate when others have more? Do I envy the families of others or possessions of others? Am I greedy or selfish? Are material possessions the purpose of my life? All of us have sinned. And as we kneel now, please kneel. We will make our communal act of contrition. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault, therefore, the Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters,
pray for me to the Lord our God.
And all of us tonight, is our penance, we will pray three Our Fathers, three Hail Marys, and three Glory Bes for the intentions of our Holy Father, Pope Francis. Three Our Fathers, three Hail Marys, and three Glory Bes. Let us pray those prayers together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace.
The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary,
Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not
into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Hail Mary.
Mary, full of grace. And blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Hail Mary. As we will approach the great sacrament of reconciliation, it is not a time for you to seek counseling. It's a time for you to experience in a real way, in a sacramental way, the forgiveness of the God who loves you. You will come up to the priests and you will confess your sins. That is, you will tell the priest your sins, not where it happened or how it happened or with whom it happened, but just what happened. You will say that to the priest and then experience the forgiveness as the priest gives you, in the name of Jesus, the absolution, the forgiveness of your sins. Then, as a sign of that forgiveness, that your soul is restored, as this paper is white, all the marks, all the sins will be wiped away, clean. And then, as in baptism, and when you go to be baptized, you know that you receive a candle because you are to be the light of Christ. And so here, you will then come up that light again, which is extinguished by our sins, is being again through the sacrament of reconciliation lit. And you will come up and you will light a candle here by the image of the merciful Jesus that we have here. And then you will go back and you will pray. Pray for all those people who have not yet had their confessions heard. You will not go home. Because forgiveness happens in community. When you sin, you just don't hurt yourself, you hurt others. We are a community. So we will go back to our seats. None of this, I have to go home. It's the last day of the mission. We're all going to come back and we're going to pray for one another. You are here to experience a time of healing. Remove yourself from all those worries that you may be experiencing in your life. What you can do today can also be done tomorrow. You've got time. You're here with God. Be grateful. So come back to your seats. Don't leave after you have received absolution and forgiveness for your sins. We have a lot of priests here, and it's going to go very quick. And so, as we are graced with music during the time of reconciliation, there will be music during that time, and it's a time for us to pray for that gift of the Lord in our lives. And then at the end, the reason why you have to stay is because you will be given, those who have attended the mission, and all of you have, even if you're just here tonight, we will give you the apostolic blessing, And then we've prayed for the intentions of our Holy Father. You will go to confession. And then in the next 7 days, you will receive Holy Communion when you come to Mass. And you will gain not only sacramental forgiveness, which you will receive here, but also a plenary indulgence, which is that grace of the Lord that forgives us those temporal punishments of our sins. And so it's a beautiful gift that we will receive here, which is why you can't go home, because that we will give you as priests at the end of our time together. And so now Father Bob, our pastor, is going to come up and he's going to give you instructions about the confession time as we get ready to confess our sins here tonight.
Our priest, Father Bob Kiefer, please come forward.
Father Bob is retired.
And Father Bob will be over here in this corner of the sanctuary. Father Adam will be in the center. And then on the right side of the sanctuary will be Father Waninsky. Father Ted is the pastor of St. John of
Blessed are they who through their lifetime sow seeds of peace. All will call them children of the Lord. Blessed are you, though persecuted in your holy life.
For these 4 nights, and now as Father Bob comes up, the pastor here at St. Anthony's, I want to thank him for the gracious invitation, and to Father Steve, and I'm really impressed because I've been in other parishes where I've done missions and retreats or talks, and many times the priests do not show up. They have been here every night. That's leading by example, right? Absolutely. Thank you, Father Bob, and thank you, Father Steve.
I get to sleep in tomorrow. A wonderful, wonderful 4 days, and it's been a great earth-shattering for all of you, but it's been an increase in vocation for Father Steve and myself. Father Adam, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father Adam has brought out the best in all of us. Amen?
Amen.
Now, we have to go out and show that best to everyone else. You look around, see all the empty seats around you? We're going to fill them. Not at the 10 o'clock Mass, though. We've got enough. But the other Masses, we need to fill them. And it's always been my vision that ever since we built this, and when we finally invited them still around to build the actual church, that those back doors would be swinging different directions so that there'd be different nationalities coming in here, different organizations that will be coming in here. We have started, and more people are coming. And thanks to Father Adam, and thank God to God, the Father, God, the Son, God, the Holy Spirit, and all our wonderful choir who bring us music. We twice pray. And so I sing all the time, if God has given you that beautiful voice, give it back to Him. And tell Paul to see, give it back and turn your microphone off. Anyways, it's wonderful that we've all been here tonight, and we give God thanks for Father Adam. He comes clear across from Sahara to here, but he's coming. He's come past those waters. As I told you before, Sahara's Boulevard has not been a good place for me to go because too many people, like when he was getting the half a lion sign, I was getting many of those on Sahara, so I don't usually cross over Sahara. But Father Adam has dared to come here, and I think he likes it here. My patron saint is Don Bosco. And Don Bosco, the children, the youth, used to fight among themselves to say that they were the ones liked by Don Bosco the most, and they would fight. Well, Father Adam, no matter where he goes, he's always smiling and he's telling us and loving the Lord. So here he is at St. Anthony, and we love him the best. And he goes back to St. Joseph, and they love him the best. And he goes to St. Francis, and he goes to Christ the King, and he goes no matter where he goes, because he takes the Lord with him, and they love him the best. I want to thank you again. We couldn't have handled everything that we've been doing these 4 days without the ushers, without the hospitality people, without Wally and Aggie's wife, hospitality of maintenance, keeping this place clean so you have toilet paper every time you look at it. That's Wally and his wife Maggie. We couldn't have done it without them. I want to thank them. Environment people, the art and environment people that are in this parish, they were here today doing all this till noon, early in the morning till noon. They will not allow me to mention their names because every time I do, I get an earful, so I can't, but you know who they are. And if you don't, God knows. He takes care of them all. So I want to thank them. And I have to thank everyone for coming. You know, as Father Adam said last night, coming here 4 days, you can't get this in many parishes. I came from California. I came from that poor county called Orange County. Remember, I was in the San Clemente, the poorest town. Over my bedroom, the water rolled over, and I had to listen to those waves every night. But nowhere, not even in San Clemente, at Our Lady of Fatima, have we had crowds like this every night for 4 days. Maybe we start off good, and everybody comes with a great attitude the first night, and then a little drip, drip, drip. And we get to the fourth night, have 15, I remember one night, we had 15 priests, we had 14 people.
Before the three of us give you the apostolic blessing, I would just like to also recognize Deacon Antonio, who is here. And you know, we are celibate. We don't have a family, and this is our job. But he has a full-time job and a wife and children, and he's been here each and every night. So. And you are going to receive a plenary indulgence today. To fulfill the requirements of the plenary indulgence, you have gone to confession. We have prayed for the intentions of our Holy Father, Pope Francis. And then you have to receive within the next 7 days Holy Communion. What is a plenary indulgence? Well, it would be a long explanation. That's why what you're going to do is go on BibleCatholic.net if you don't know what it is. And we will place on there an explanation of what a plenary indulgence is, and maybe even on the parish website of St. Anthony as well, what a plenary indulgence is. Okay? And so let us stand and let us pray.
Before you do that, just tell them about the tapes in Bible Catholic.
And the tapes, thank you, Father Steve, the tapes of these four nights will also be available on BibleCatholic.net. Okay, so you can go over them as well. We will place them within the next one or 2 weeks because we have to format them and edit them.
One more thing. When you go out this evening, you might start to your car and you'll be filled with light around you. But at 10 o'clock, the lights go off. So get your phones out and use your flashlights.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Authority given us as priests of Jesus Christ by the authority of the Apostolic See, we now, the three of us, give you this blessing with the plenary indulgence. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Be merciful, just as your Heavenly Father is merciful. Go in peace.
Thank you.